Hello everybody, it's a pleasure to be with you today and have the opportunity to talk about digital assets and DLTs. So my name is Leandre and I'm working at Murex and heading the DLT initiatives and the digital asset initiatives. At Murex, we are convinced that the digital asset and the distributed ledger technologies will have the potential in the future to reshape and disrupt our market infrastructure. And as a system provider for capital markets, we are exploring what are the technological opportunities that the DLTs and digital assets will bring to us, but also to our customer. So let's get started with this presentation, and in particular, how the standardization will shape the future of our ecosystem. So it will be in two steps. The first one, we will do an overview of the ecosystem. So we will try to see all the technical opportunities around DLT that we have today, but also in terms of digital assets. And in the second time, we will look at use cases. So we will explore why standards are really important and why we will need to have standardization in all the deployment of digital assets inside distributed ledger technologies. So we will first have a look at the ecosystem overview. So we will start with the most important, the catalyst, why we are here today, is because first of Bitcoin that started in 2009. So the first peer-to-peer cash system deployed on a public blockchain using the Bitcoin coin. And as a pure, and this Bitcoin is the first pure digital asset as a stored of value and medium of exchanges. So it was meant only for that at the beginning. But this gave idea to other people, and that was the Ethereum. There's much more ambitions when they started. They wanted to have a distributed, secure, permissionless ecosystem that was using decentralized application. On the same concept as Ethereum, in terms of infrastructure, it was on a public blockchain, and they wanted really to have much more services and features than just a pure digital asset. They wanted to have the capability to deploy utility token, to deploy smart contracts on it, non-fungible token, distributed storage, decentralized finance, and many, many other applications that can be decentralized and put in a public blockchain. But the story didn't stop there, because some people said, OK, this ecosystem is good, but it's not enough good for investment banking. So we have seen a lot of factors that were exploring this new infrastructure along the years, and I will mention three of them. Other public infrastructure DLTs, so not only more blockchains, but also DLTs that are more generic terms for this kind of infrastructure. We will have a look at private DLTs and centralized exchange that are playing a major role also in this ecosystem. So the objective of a public DLT was really to enhance or compete against Ethereum. It was not to do something more. They really wanted to enhance what we call today the Web3. So we can mention some of them. So in terms of enhancement, we have, for example, the Lightning Network. We have Immutable. We have Polygon that wanted to also enhance Ethereum. But we have also some infrastructure DLTs that want to compete against Ethereum. Polkadot, Solana, TRX, ADA, and many others. All deployed on a public, so permissionless DLT, and they are really trying to improve two aspects of the Bitcoin and Ethereum: the scalability, the throughput of insertion, and the cost and energy efficiency, so the cost of transactions. Then we have seen also other actors, private DLT. They came with another concept. They are saying, okay, public DLT is very good, but for some business cases, I don't want everybody to have a look at our transaction. I don't want everybody to have the capability to join our network. So a few companies say we want to create what we call today enterprise DLTs that have permissioning. So two layers of permissioning. The first one, who can join the network? And the second layer, which kind of transaction I have access to this network as an actor of the network. This is what we call today a private DLT. It's exactly like the public one. Some of them do not even have consensus mechanism, which makes them really cost efficient. And we have, of course, a permission access. And some of them even addresses the ESG concerns of the public DLTs. For example, some of them say, I want to be carbon neutral in terms of energy efficiency on private DLT. This gives you another tooling in order to explore the DLTs, not just permissionless activities. And the last one, they are the centralized exchange. They have completely another mindset. They wanted just to ease the access of the crypto market to all the participants. First, the retail customers, and more today, the institutional banking. So what they are trying, so they are completely centralized in terms of infrastructure, but connected to all the protocols. And what they are trying to achieve is really to mask the complexity to all the actors of accessing the DLT, using a DLT, using a wallet, a cold wallet, hot wallet. They want to say, okay, let's get rid of that. I will give you the same experience as you have today in normal exchange, so traditional finance exchange, but on a new asset and a new product. The little differences with the other centralized exchange is that they don't act just as a centralized exchange, they also act as a custodian and as liquidity provider, which is much more powerful in terms of infrastructure. But it allows quickly institutions and retail customers to access this new market by providing the same services as in public DLT, and for some of them, extra services, new products. And this is exactly what we will see today. Assets on this new ecosystem. I will not mention the cryptocurrencies, because we all know the cryptocurrencies. It's really the fuel in order to register a transaction in a public blockchain or by using a decentralized application. But I prefer to focus on all the other type of assets that really brings new capabilities for investment banking. So first, the derivative product and security token through the development of a smart contract. So this really has several objectives. The first one was the creation of what we call today the decentralized finance. So having the capability to deploy products in a public blockchain in order to provide new services for retail customers. But some of them are also used to new deployment model. So I want to say, I have an existing solution, but I want to deploy it differently using smart contract and DLT capabilities. I want to enhance and optimize my process. This is what we will see later in the use case, how this smart contract can be used to completely rethink and enhance all the capabilities of our market infrastructure. We have a lot of services that can be deployed thanks to smart contracts. I've just mentioned some of them that already exist: lending, borrowing, insurance, trading, synthetic assets, loyalty dividend, and many, many other smart contracts that can be deployed on whether private, public DLT, but also on centralized exchanges. We have seen a lot of derivative products being deployed since the last year in centralized institutions to allow institutions to expose themselves to cryptocurrencies. Then we have seen a lot since 2020, the rise of the stablecoin. It's a one-to-one peg to a fiat currency. It was really used for the decentralized finance to have an asset which can minimize the price fluctuations against the market. It's a really, it stabilizes its value relative to a stable asset. Usually it's against a fiat currency, but it could be also against a basket of assets. Today we have mainly stablecoin pegged to the US dollar, but we have seen more and more Swiss franc and other type of stablecoins. They are mainly issued in public DLTs today, but they could be also deployed in private DLTs, but they are all issued by private companies today. So the pegging mechanism is managed by a centralized organization against, again, dollar or any other stable asset. The last one, the non-fungible token. So be reassured, I will not talk about digital art and all that. I will just try to give you the objective of a non-fungible token. It's really an authenticity and proof of ownership. Okay, that was the intention of the creation of the non-fungible token. And it's really a unique, traceable digital token that represents the ownership of a digital good. Today, they are mainly deployed in public DLTs, but they also could be deployed in private DLTs for other purposes. We will have a concrete example on how NFT can be used later on a security lending borrowing context. Once we have said that, we have kind of a good panel of digital assets, but we have seen that the innovation continues more and more. We have heard a lot, and I saw a lot of conferences during the two past days about the central bank digital currencies. So really, the central bank digital currencies are really like a stablecoin, but issued by a central bank. I put question mark because we don't know yet how this CBDC will be deployed and used in the ecosystem, most probably for a new payment ecosystem, maybe complementing or replacing the cash, but it could be also used as the digital asset for replatforming, like digital issuance, secondary market, and deployment of really new derivative product. We don't know yet in which kind of infrastructure they will be deployed. It could be private or public DLT. We have seen already both use cases being blocked by some central banks. And we don't know if it will be one central bank digital currency, several. It will depend on the region. We have heard that in Europe, we want to have maybe wholesale CBDC for the interbank system and maybe a retail CBDC for the retail. We have seen in the US also initiative to have more wholesale CBDC deployed for interbank use case. So it will be very interesting to see. But at the end, for me, the only feature that that brings is to have a legal digital tender currency deployed on a DLT. And that will clearly enhance the way we will be able to settle derivative product and smart contract into this ecosystem. The last one, very new, Soulbound token. So thank you for Warcraft about that. It's really the cornerstone for a trusted decentralized society, so it's quite new. It's not today even appearing in the system. They are under development. It's just a white paper about that. They tended to be deployed on the public DLT, and it's very simple to understand. It's a non-transferable NFT that is revocable by its creator. This will have the potential to completely unleash the capabilities of public DLTs to do permission and to have trust. Because today, all the public DLT has completely untrusted environment. We don't know who we are trading. We don't know who can access the network, and we don't know who can access the decentralized application. The Soulbound token will be the opportunity to have decentralized identities, to have credit score, if you want, for example, an uncollateralized loan, to have rating, if you want to be an issuer and accessing a minting platform and be able to issue your own private debt or your own securities. So this will be, for the future, a way to have permissioning on all this public ecosystem.
Is it like the Chinese model? No. Say some rating?
The Soulbound token is just a digital asset that is allowing you, it's an NFT that is non-transferable. So it's just a concept today that has been issued by the creator of Ethereum in order to completely have a trusted decentralized society. So it's just a token that I will give you as a centralized entity. I'm saying you are you. And I will be able to base my permissioning saying I will allow to access my decentralized application only the people that have on their wallet this Soulbound token. Once they have this Soulbound token in this wallet, I can say you will have access to the service or even the network. So it's a way to have permissioning. Exactly, it's decentralized identity. Yes, exactly. So if we see, as a summary, we have a lot of capabilities today and a lot of tooling in order to completely rethink our market infrastructure. We have public DLTs and private DLT, in addition of all the centralized organizations that we already know, and a lot of digital assets that can be deployed on them. Cryptocurrencies, stablecoin, derivative products, security token, NFTs, and maybe in the future, CBDCs and Soulbound token. Now we have seen that we have a lot of existing and a lot of potential. We will see, okay, how to project that in use cases. So I will take simple use cases. I will try to make them very, very simple without a lot of intermediary, just to show the potential. I'm not saying this is what we need to do, but it will show you what we can do with the existing, and then exploring why standards are very important. Because that's also a very important piece of all the equation. First, I will take the digital issuance process. So I will do something very simple. An application based on the private DLT. Why private DLT? Because I'm saying I don't want everybody to access the primary market. I want only my investor and my issuers to be controlled by a centralized entity. And I don't want everybody to be able to mint a security and to buy and sell securities on the primary market. It's a choice, could be completely public, but it's a choice. Then I have one decentralized application that will act as a primary market exchange and minting platform for the issuer. On top of that, first, I will also deploy a centralized exchange that will act only for one purpose, being able to exchange my fiat currencies against CBDCs. Okay? So for that, I will have first the inversor that will connect to the centralized exchange, do an onboarding, a KYC process, and have the capabilities to exchange and asking the centralized exchange that will clearly act as a bridge between the off-chain ecosystem, the one that we know today, and the on-chain ecosystem, which is the blockchain, the private DLT. And they will be able to swap fiat currencies against CBDCs on a wallet that will be permissioned. Okay. Once we have that, the issuer will do exactly the same. They will onboard and do their KYC process. Once they have done that, they can connect, so the issuer, they can connect its wallet directly to the decentralized application and do the minting of the security. Once they have done that, they will be able to list their securities. So it could be a bond, it could be an equity or any debt issuance. And then the investor will do the same. They will connect their wallet on which they have already CBDCs. And they will be able to swap the securities against the CBDC. This will have a lot of advantages. First, this private DLT will act as an authoritative data store for all the transactions that has been done on the primary market. It will provide speed, of course, speed of exchange, because it will be an atomic swap between the security and the settlement, so no more settlement delay. We will have also the transparency. We could say the regulator will join the network, and this regulator will be able to see in real time all the transactions, all the minting, and then all the issuance that are being done in this ecosystem. Once we have done that, and of course efficiency, because there is there is less intermediary possible. We could add intermediary to validate, to verify, but we could even have only no intermediary, like we see today in the decentralized finance, and to have a more efficient way to settle and exchange securities. Now we will continue, because I have bought securities, but I want to resell my securities. So let's do a simple exercise. I want to have access to the maximum person to rebuy and resell my securities. So I will go to the secondary market, and I want to deploy a decentralized exchange on a public DLT. So allowing me to list my securities on this decentralized exchange, public DLT, and to swap them against, or it could be CBDC, if we have maybe today a retail CBDC, but it could be completely a stable coin. A stable coin maybe even issued by banks, pegged thanks to the CBDC. Or it could be also against the cryptocurrency. So we are using, for this example, a lot of digital assets and infrastructure. But once we have done that, it's very simple. The seller connects its wallet and put an order to sell. And the buyer connects its wallet and put an order to buy. Very simple. We have seen that a lot already in decentralized exchange. This could be completely applicable on investment banking. We could have decentralized exchange. And we have seen even POC today doing so on CBDCs, but it could be also for security. Once we have done that, here we already have a problem. We have two ecosystems, one private DLT and one public DLT. I need to be able to deploy the same smart contracts, the same security token, in both private DLT and public DLT. And for that, I need what? I need a bridge. We all heard about bridges in the DLT and cryptocurrency ecosystem. These bridges will allow me to transfer my security from my private DLT to the public one. And for that, this is where the standardization will be key in this process. Because I need to be able to easily deploy the same smart contract in two different infrastructures. I will need to be able to also execute the smart contract event, detachment of coupon, special dividend, and many other events that can happen on the security. I need to be able to execute them smoothly in both ecosystems. And also, we need a strong bridge implementation. We have seen over the past years and even weeks bridges that was hacked because the data were transformed from one blockchain to another. The data was validated, and it was a vulnerability on the bridge, and people was allowed to do that. And this is where the standardization will help building strong bridges, but also transferring easily all those assets from one blockchain to another. We have seen a lot of initiatives trying to do that. We have the ISDA CDM, so the Common Domain Model, the ISO 20022, and also the smart contract standard deployment, ERC20, ERC721, BEP20, and many other smart contract initiatives. And if we go a little bit even further, once I have rebuilt the security, I might want to put the security as collateral and borrow some cash. We have seen this example a lot today in the decentralized finance. This could be also applied for the investment banking. So we could have a decentralized non-custodial liquidity market where, as a borrower, I will create a vault. This vault represented today as an NFT in this ecosystem. I will be able to deposit my security in this vault. And thanks to that, I will be able to borrow CBDCs, if we have a CBDC on this ecosystem, but also stablecoin on any other assets that are listed on this decentralized application. Once we have done that, it will be very interesting because it could be a permission application, thanks to Solbond token, or it could be a permissionless with know your transaction process in order to know who can access these services. Once we have done that, but we have still even more problems because now we have three different DLTs, so we have a completely fragmented market, because in each implementation, I want, for example, to leverage the privacy for the private DLT, the fact that I need here a permissioning access and a permissionless application on this DLT. So I will learn to take the best of each DLT, but for the same process using the same smart contract. And this is where the standardization will be compulsory in this ecosystem. Because imagine here, we have a fourth DLT allowing you to have the corporate actions. So storing the corporate action, you need to have the oracle of each blockchain being able to execute the corporate action at the same time in all this ecosystem without any issues. So this is where the standardization of data, but also of processes, will be very, very important on this ecosystem. And this is why it's even smarter to say, if I don't have yet the standardization on all this ecosystem, it will be the prerequisite of that. If we want just to implement one of these use cases in this kind of ecosystem without any standardization, we can do it, but we are just creating new silos that will be completely complex to have interoperability. You will create complex bridge, and if you create complex bridges, but you will have a lack of security. The less transformation of data we have against each protocols, and the better the bridge will be. And this is what way to think. So if we want to take key takeaways, we have to explore the uses across initiatives, meaning that when we are looking at digital standard, we need to think, does my digital standard is applicable and usable in a digital asset and DLTs? But not only, when you are looking at digital asset and DLTs, do I have a use case, a proper use case, with a digital standard? So saying that we should go beyond the technology and and assess the value of the use case. For some of the use cases, there is maybe no values on implementing this process inside the DLT. So maybe a centralized DB will be more than enough, and you don't need a DLT. But if you need a DLT, always think of digitalization and digital standard. Because for that, it will help you to enhance later on all the other processes and to leverage clearly the capabilities of the DLT. That's why we are saying that taking together all those initiatives, digital standard initiatives, digital asset and DLTs will clearly enable the capital market infrastructure to be more efficient, more transparent, scalable, innovative, and safe. Thank you very much. And if you have questions, please don't hesitate. Yeah?
Can you give an example of a private DLT?
Yes, of course. Yeah, we have. Alors, the question was, do we have an example of a private DLT? We have a lot of companies doing private DLT. We have digital asset, we have a Corum, R3, Corda. Hyperledger, we have Axcor also, of Axony, we have a lot of private DLT. They are really good DLTs that allow permissioning and scalability and efficiency of cost of transaction, low cost of transaction, or even for some of them, no cost of transaction, because it's embedded, yeah. More question? Yes?
Thank you. So I fully understand the need for standardization. So A, how can it be brought about, point one? And if, when looking at what you showed before, that one has to be interoperable between different DLT platforms anyway, is it the problem that one could also then be able to interoperate with actually the existing infrastructure?
Yes. Oh, that's a very good question. Yes, it will be also the capability to interoperate with the existing infrastructure, of course. If we look at some initiative, we look at, for example, ISDA CDM, but we have also ICMA CDM, ISO 20022, what's really trying to bring a standard of data and processes. It helps to do what? To have a proper data modeled in a DLT, and also to be able to execute events in a smoothest way. It's important to have this. We could not have a digital standard. Each of them can completely rethink of their own model in different DLT, but the problem that we will have is that you will have to build bridges and you have to transform the data. We have already experienced that today in our current infrastructure, and it's very complex to have proper interoperability and reconciliation. So the objective here is to completely remove the reconciliation and the need of reconciliation. So the DLT is made for that, is to have a single authoritative data source that it shares among all the actors. If we start fragmenting the infrastructure, we will require a standardization. We could take completely another approach. We could say, let's not fragment the infrastructure. We have only one DLT, one digital standard, and that's all. And we build all our application on the same blockchain. But maybe in this case, you will not leverage all the other DLT capabilities. Some of them are faster than the others, some of them are cheaper than the others, some of them are ESG compliant. It's complex to have on the same DLT all the capabilities together. So that's why we should think that, okay, let's imagine that the world will be completely fragmented, and in this case, the standardization will be key for that.